Bet you gone fishing all the time. Baby gone fishing too. Bet your life, your sweet wife.
Hi, I would like to introduce you to my friend, Dr. Tim Berra, whom I met in Florida, where he lives part of the year. Dr. Berra is an ichthyologist, which is a kind of scientist who studies fish. He's not called doctor because you go see him when you're sick. He's called doctor because he has something called a PhD. If you have a PhD, that means you studied for many years after college about something you were really interested in. It doesn't have to be fish. It doesn't even have to be science. You can get a PhD about anything that really interests you. Dr. Berra has written many books and he's given talks all over the world. And he doesn't just study fish in a lab. He goes out to where the fish are and studies them in rivers. So let's meet Dr. Berra and hear about what it's like to be a scientist.
He is going fishing. Yes, okay. He's going.
Hi, Dr. Berra.
Hey, Janice.
What kind of advice would you have for my student, Jakobe, who is interested in becoming an ichthyologist when he grows up?
Well, I would say one of the first things that's important for a scientist is that you need to read constantly. For a young student, I would say soak yourself in facts. Read, read, read. Read books about the exploration of jungles and the ocean and the deserts. Read natural history. Read about whales and about certain fishes that you might be interested in. Read about freshwater. Read about saltwater. And this becomes a lifelong learning. You never outgrow the need to read about science.
You mentioned something that your family did that you're grateful for that helped you become a scientist.
Well, I read all the time as a kid, and I would bring a book to the dinner table, and my dad would say, you know, come on now, we're having dinner. And my mom would say, oh, let him read, let him read. And I dedicated one of my books to my mother for allowing me to read at the table. It's my book on evolution, and it says, for my mother, who allowed me to read during meals. And Carl Sagan, the astronomer, picked up on that in one of the books he read that or he wrote that was recommending my book, and he thought that was a nice feature of the book.
How did you first become interested in studying about fish?
Well, as a kid, I read a lot, but I also kept tropical fishes in my bedroom. So I had aquariums, and when you get these fish, you need to read about them to know how to keep them, what they are, where they came from. Are they South American or are they African? What do they need to be happy in the aquarium? What kind of food do they eat? Are they vegetarians? Are they carnivores? All of this hobby information goes to a career down the road.
What kind of tropical fish did you have?
Oh, I had the usual thing of carassins, angelfish, guppies, tetras, you name it, I had it at one time or another.
And what did you think was interesting about fish?
Well, I love to watch them, their beauty of their swimming around and so forth, and their behavior. They do interesting things. For example, some are live bearers, which means they mate and give birth to live young. Others are egg layers, so they will lay an egg rather than give birth to live young.
So I understand that you have been all over the world studying fish. Where have you gone to do your research?
Well, I've conducted a lot of research throughout Australia. I've been about over the entire continent of Australia, which is as large as the United States, except for Alaska. And I work in rivers primarily, and I have worked in the Northern Territory, in the tropics, which is what I've been doing since 2001. I've made 8 trips in the last 16 years or so studying this nursery fish thing, the males of which carry the eggs on a hook on their head. It's very bizarre. No other fish in the world does this.
The males carry the eggs.
Males carry the eggs. He's doing his fair share of parenting, you know. And the place is so amazing. I mean, I am surrounded by huge saltwater crocodiles that are bigger than my boat. these things are about 16 feet long, or 5 meters, and they come jumping out of the water. And it's just really exciting to see this.
That sounds kind of dangerous.
Well, you have to pay attention to what you're doing, that's for sure. And you don't dare go in the water. You can't get in the water or let your feet dangle from the boat or anything. That would not be good. I set nets for collecting these fish, big long gill nets, and then I have to take the fish out and reset the net and do this about every 20 minutes or so and turn loose the things I don't want. Other places that I work, I use electrofishing. I shock the fish with electricity.
Wow.
And it doesn't harm them, it stuns them. They come up, you can dip net them out of the water, weigh them, measure them, put a tag on them and turn them loose, and they swim away quite happily. There are all kinds of ways to collect fish. Small seine nets, 10 foot long seine net. You drag it through streams. I do this on my study area in Ohio. I have 44 species of fishes in my backyard in Ohio in the Clear Fork Stream.
Did you ever find yourself in a dangerous situation when you were doing your research in Australia?
Well, in Australia, almost constantly. I mean,
can you tell us about one?
Well, we came up to our gill net after we had 2 gill nets set. Checked one, motored back to the next one, and there's this huge log about to get thrown into the net. Well, the closer we got, this log opened its mouth and started chomping. Here's a huge crocodile right in front, and he was tangled in my net.
Oh, no.
And, oh, my goodness, because they're highly protected. You can't, interfere with them. And I was afraid he would roll and drown in the net.
Did you do?
Well, we didn't want to have to try and handle him, that's for sure. I mean, this thing is 16 feet long. And weighs a couple tons, and we just watched it for a while, and it was so powerful it just tore my net to shreds and got away.
What was the most interesting discovery you made?
Well, I think understanding the life cycle of this nursery fish and working out where it lives, what time does it spawn, what's the salinity versus the freshwater component, what does it eat, how old does it get? We've done all of that with this fish. But I do other fishes besides this. I've worked on a fish in southern Australia. It smells like a cucumber.
Well, but it's not a sea cucumber.
No, it's a regular freshwater fish. But we figured out that it has the same molecule in its skin as a cucumber, and that's why it smells that way. It's called the Australian grayling.
I've
worked in Western Australia, a little tiny fish that live in pools about the size of a swimming pool. When the pool evaporates, the fish burrow down in the sand. Well, I brought fire trucks out into the field and released 2,700 liters of water into the pool and caught fish immediately. Instant fish, just add water. So that's the sort of stuff I do, and have made a career out of studying weird Australian fishes. But it all starts with you reading, Jakobe. You gotta read, read, read. And work your way up as you get through high school and then into university and into graduate school. You never outgrow that need to read.
So when we read about things in books, when we read different information about fish, somebody had to go out and do research,
right,
in order for that to be put to, for that to go in a book.
Well, in order to know what it is.
In order to find it out.
Yeah, right. That's called research. It's what PhD scientist does is research.
And do you have to go to school for a long time to be a PhD?
Yes, you have the regular university education, and after 4 or 5 years of college, then you go to graduate school. And that depends how long your research project lasts. I got through the master's and PhD in 4 years, but some students I know take 6 or 7 years. And then you often do a postdoc. I did a postdoc in Australia on the Fulbright program. That's a granting program between the governments of America and Australia, and they brought me over there to work on Australian fishes, and that led me to a lifetime of Australian studies.
What's the best thing about being a scientist?
Learning new things. And that can be your life, Jakobe, but you gotta take it one step at a time.
Thanks for talking to us, Dr. Berra.
Well, thanks for asking. See you later.
I'm going fishing, mama's going fishing, and the baby going fishing too.